Yeah, it's a pleasure to be here, and thank you for coming so numerously to my lecture. I hope I won't disappoint you. So this afternoon, I'd like to present on two topics. One is the our passion, the molecular photovoltaics. But as Paul mentioned, this has gone through some maturity. And for example, you see here the one of the applications of this invention is the are these glass panels that produce electric power from visible light. And this is a filling station. It's a filling station. It's an electric power station for these electric vehicles that you're very familiar with here in California. So I hope you're soon going to use our technology. These applications come out of fundamental research. And so in the first part of my lecture, I want to take you the path of this invention, how it emerged. Some people ask me, well, how did you invent isotized solar cells? As if I woke up one morning and I had this invention in my head. That's not how it happened, OK? And so, it's also clear that one of the most exciting developments that recently, if not the most exciting development in photovoltaics in recent years has been the perovskite solar cell, which is shown here, one of the recent papers we have. This is shown here on the left. These are really amazing materials. They over span of 6 to 7 years, the efficiencies went from 2 to 22%. And this has never happened in photovoltaics. And in addition, they can be made by solution processing. So it comes very close to the dream of having a photovoltaic paint where you would just take a brush and put the stuff on the wall and get power out of your thin film. And so the second part of the lecture, I'd like to take you along the line of development of these perovskite solar cells. So this is where we work at the Lac Léman, or Lake of Geneva in Lausanne, and here's our lab. And so energy certainly is a big issue. This is what the lecture will be about. And here's a photovoltaic. Photovoltaics have been growing, and last year we had this about 60 gigawatt peak power installed. And so that, why is it going to go down next year or this year? Well, here's the problem, okay? The feed-in tariffs, it's all said here, the story is being told, have been decreasing. And so it shows you this technology, I mean, it's mainly silicon, 90% silicon, is still living on subsidies. And if subsidies go down, then the sales drop. So this has to change. So there's room for developing technologies that, number one, are not depending on subsidies. And you also need just the sheer volume. I mean, it sounds a lot to 50 gigawatts, sounds a lot. But just think about it. We're consuming 16 terawatt, OK? That's permanent. And those 50, that's peak power. So divide by 5, you get the average power. So it's actually 10 gigawatt average power. So we're missing a factor of 1,000 here, okay? So if we would install at that present rate, the photovoltaics, it would take 1,000 years to get to those 10 terawatt to make an impact, okay? So definitely there's room for new technologies. And the good news for you folks is that the funding will be there, okay? Over $1 trillion is expected to be spent in the next 20 years on solar PV, and along with other renewables. And so this, who will be the winner? Well, this is the famous triangle. So efficiency, stability, and cost. We know what will count, okay? So I will come back to this triangle at the end of my lecture. And so, one winner is certainly at the moment photosynthesis. Photosynthesis has 1,000 terawatt power storage, okay? Just think about the 50 gigawatt or the 10 gigawatt we have with the PV, okay, 1,000 towers. So that's what inspired us, the light reaction photosynthesis, which works well since 2 billion years. And so we have our initial thinking was to try to mimic that reaction by using molecular absorbers. It's molecular photovoltaics, using molecular absorber to interact with sunlight. And so I will be putting this machine in motion in a minute. So it's a molecular sensitizer, not a diode. Absorbs light, a photodiode is a molecular sensitizer. And we get this photo coming in, pumping the electron up, injection, collection. Then the electron does work. Then we bring it back to the sensitizer. And very, very important is this redox shuttle. It's for a while we got stuck with a one single redox shuttle, the iodide triodide. And you see the problem with that, it's in the middle of the gap. And so all this energy is wasted here. So for many years, we stuck with 12% because of that major loss here. But this has changed. And recently, there was a breakthrough with the new copper complexes that work beautifully in the solid state, in the liquid. And I'll share some of this with you shortly. So the outline, then we will talk about this molecular photovoltaics and then turn to the perovskite solar cells. So it makes big difference if you put a sensitizer on a flat surface or on this nano crystalline film. The yields in photocon go up 10,000 times. It's amazing. I mean, this piece of material costs $50,000 to make, okay? And that costs about $0.50 to make. But it gives you 10,000 times more power out. So stunning. And why is it so good? Well, you absorb light, and the important thing is you're able not only to absorb light, but you generate charge and you collect those charges. And the product is close to 100%. The EQE is shown here, over 90%. If you have it on a flat surface, 0.1%. And so that tells you the story. This system is working well. The mesoscale is doing a miracle for you. Okay, and so we explored what the reason for this was, and I don't want to go through too much of theoretical details here. So what is the scaffold doing? It's a force sensitizer. The nanoparticles are stacked, so you get the light absorbed, although there's only a monolayer of dye on the surface of these particles. And here's the important second function. Scaffold extracts selectively electrons from the excited sensitizer. And the nanoparticles screen the electronic charges. Just think about it. Under full sunlight, each of those nanoparticles has about 20 electrons inside. And so usually we think, well, how is that possible to squeeze 20 negative charges in such a small particle? There's a Coulomb blockade effect. But no, it's possible because you got those charges screened by the ions on the surface. And so here just shows you the staining of the film, of the nanocrystalline film. It happens spontaneously. It's a self-assembly that happens spontaneously. And it darkens your film. Here we have this ruthenium dye as a sensitizer that hooks on the surface through the carboxylate group. We can image that those dyes. This has been done on a single crystal. And you can see how the sensitizer sits on the surface. You can also massage these images and find out more how, for example, here you see a dimer formed between two sensitizers. And we find that the carboxylates go on bidentate. They bridge two titanium, adjacent titanium ions on the surface. It's a bidentate coordinative binding. And so all this information Wow. I'm sorry. I have to go back to PowerPoint went out. Don't know why. Okay, so now let's just quickly run through the slides. If I try to do anything else, it might upset the... Okay, I think we got just to this stage where I told you we can massage these SCM photos, and we get information on the binding. And here's a quantum mechanic calculation that shows how the charge is injected. And you have to metal the ligand charge transfer on excitation, and the charge is injected within a few femtoseconds. But then nothing happens. I mean, this, you see a flat signal here, and that tells you the back reaction is a much slower time scale than the forward injection. That's the trick. Actually, there is a factor of 10 to the 9 in the rate of the back electron transfer with regards to forward. And this is what made that photovoltaic system work. It's a kinetic observation. And so injection, regeneration. And so the important thing is that you can collect the charges before they recombine. This is the key thing, the transport time, recombination time. If your transport is 100 times faster than recombination, then you collect 99%. And for many systems, it's possible to do that, to get those ratios that you need to collect fully the charges that are injected in the nanocrystalline film. That was one of the physicists' main argument against this concept. They said, well, we believe you can absorb light, you can inject electrons, but you will never collect those charges because there's no field to separate the positive and negative charge. But that was wrong. We were able to collect very, very efficiently those charges. And so this paper came out in 1991. It has received over 17,000 citations since then. And it was cited so highly because of the change in paradigm. We went from the flat p-n junction to this three-dimensional nanoparticle network that served as electron-selective contact. And I should mention to you, I just found out that I don't want to brag with my citation. this thing was, I ignored for a long time that we were actually the first 100 of ever published scientific papers. And actually, our citations have gone up to 17,000. So the rate of citations is 2,000 a year, of this paper still. That's quite a score. So that means every day you can calculate, we get eight citations. So let's go far away from the citation thing. But it's also this whole thing spread. These nano quantum dots, they are used as in replacement of sensitizers, and we have the solid state system. And I should mention to you that the perovskite solar cell started out as a quantum dot sensitized mesoscopic solar cell. It's like a DSC, but replace the dye by a quantum dot sensitizer, you get the perovskite solar cell how it was originally. And also the patent applications, we had first one patent, it was totally ignored. We couldn't even license it to anybody. Then we took a few more, and then this whole thing took off. And so we were able to license, after that interest took such big proportions. And so, today the original sensitizers that were ruthenium complexes, they are replaced by the so-called donor acceptor dyes. Don't want to dwell too long on this, but you will understand if I have a structure like that where the molecule has a donor moiety and a chromophore and an acceptor, when you excite the dye, the electron goes from top to bottom and it finds the particles there, it gets injected. But the positive hole that remains behind is on the donor, is up there. So if the electron wants to come back out, which it loves to do, it loves to recombine, but it's far away, That hole is far away, and that makes the charge separation so long-lived. So it's the molecular design of your dye that helps you to achieve those great photovoltaic results. And so we have this green dye, which was designed in this fashion, and did some molecular enormous calculations and computational help to design new sensitizers like the one we have here with this extra acceptor. So this field has taken off in the sense that it's now possible on the computer in silico, you can design your dyes and you can predict with a high accuracy of 0.1 eV the absorption properties of those sensitizers. And so recently, as I mentioned to you, we found these copper complexes, and the difference is here in this slide. You see, when you excite and inject, then the regeneration of the sensitizer costs only 100 millielectron volts. So it's like a silicon photovoltaic, okay? There's very little loss. And not surprisingly, that has helped to move forward with these are now solid state. This copper complex is actually a whole conductor, and it's in the solid state. And so solid state cells have been made. And here's the latest invention. We have co-sensitized with two sensitizers. And this is a photovoltaic cell. It doesn't look like one, but it's a photovoltaic cell. And believe it or not, it beats gallium arsenide in performance, okay? And so the color is the combined color of these two dyes. And here you see the impressive performance. The EQE goes to 90%. 90% of all the incoming photons are turned into electron, okay? You see the high voltage we can get out of this. And so the verdict is here, 1,000 lux in ambient light. You can extract more power out of this device. And I'll show you later the first applications we have. E-book readers that have eternal life because they get all the time powered. So there are quite a few applications that come out of this new discovery. So now let's talk about the perovskites. And yeah, we have the dye sensitized system. The perovskite cells look kind of dull. They're always black, okay? But that's what you get. If you want to absorb all the sunlight, the invisible, it will look black. The, why does it do that to me? Somebody must have bad intentions here. And so, okay, we have just to go through the routine one more time. Wow. So the sad news is I have to go through the whole thing now, and because I distrust your electronics. So we were here at this point, and now let's go to the perovskites. Go to these. So the strong absorbers. All of this is typical for a direct band gap material. It's also a material that doesn't form excitons, so the excitons dissociate easily. But the real interest in this material is it comes defect free. It has a valence band maximum that is formed by antibonding orbitals. And so suppose you take a silicon cell, you break the silicon-silicon bond, it makes you a defect right in the middle of the band gap, which will be a recombination center. If you break the bond between the lead and the iodide, you actually stabilize the whole system because you break something that is antibonding. It's kind of a mind-boggling argument, but think about it. It's true, okay? And so we have very few defects in the band gap, and so these materials, they electronically, they are very, very interesting and high quality, even though you don't grow single crystals. And so as I mentioned to you, we have these quantum dot cells. They started with the quantum dot cells, and we have here those quantum dots of the perovskite this time, sensitizing the TiO2. The trouble with these concepts was that they material dissolved in the electrolyte within 10 minutes. You had 10 minutes time to take your JV curve, and then it was gone, okay? No more sensitizer. And so, of course, that wasn't a very sustainable solution. But it turned out if you swapped the electrolyte with the Hall conductor, then it's a solid state Hall conductor, then the whole thing became much more stable. And this is what happened. Two papers appeared almost simultaneously. And this kind of put the field on track with this whole concept to have a Hall selective contact, solid state, electron selective contact. And you can see efficiency is going up and the number of papers. Now we have 2,000 or 3,000 papers published. A few years ago, we had only one paper published. It was totally ignored. Okay. And so incredible evolution of this field. And so you see why I'm sure that we have 3,000 papers. Well, we have 2,700 citations. And each citation is a paper, dear friends, okay? So we must have at least that many papers out. And so we also start infiltrating the porous space. And this evolved to, finally, there is now two configurations. And we have the mesoscopic, which always has a capping layer of perovskites on top. And this is a planar configuration. And so which one is better? They're close, but so far the highest efficiencies, certified efficiencies, have been reached with the mesoscopic film. And so also the mixtures, you have these now cation mixtures that today's formulations use. And the story is we started with the former medenium, which is not stable as a perovskite phase at room temperature. But if you put a little bit of methylammonium in a mixture, then you get a stable phase. There was a discovery that was made by my graduate student, Norman Pellet. And we have said here in this paper, this concept has not been applied previously in perovskite-based solar cells. It shows great potential. But everybody ignores this paper, okay? So I had to bang on the table and say, hey, every talk I will show the publication. So I've done that now, and so we're moving on. And so the interesting thing is if you take a cesium and form a medenium, then you have two materials that are unstable as perovskite. They form the yellow phase at room temperature. But you mix them, you get the black phase. That is magic. Okay. You can even mechanically just grind those two materials, get a black thing out. Okay. So black magic. And these mixtures are more stable than the methyl ammonium mixtures, because methyl ammonium is kind of unstable. It evolves easily as it forms methylamine and H iodide. So this is not to be recommended as a stable perovskite component. And so then triple cation started. So we went from double to triple. And we found out why these things stabilize, mainly entropically driven. And here's the triple paper, cesium. Today we have four. let's move forward. This is actually four cations. It's rubidium, cesium, methylammonium, former medenium. Now, you really need four. Well, that's how this thing evolved, okay? The four cation formulation gave us a very good voltage over 1.24 volts. And you see the stability, amazing. I mean, 85 degree plus full sunlight. And we run the cell on maximum power tracking. So we were drawing power at 85 degrees under full light. This is a double whammy stress, okay? Nobody does that usually to his photovoltaic cell. And it survived. And not only that, these cells are light emissive. And that's to be expected. A photovoltaic cell that has a high voltage at open circuit will be a good light emitter. This comes from Eli Yablonovich, but really it goes back to Ross's work and a graduate student of Melvin Calvin at Berkeley. And he came up with this equation, which is easy to derive. And so if your your voltage is an ideal voltage. That's about 4 volts then. It's the band gap minus 300 millivolts, roughly speaking. So if the perovskite has 1.6 EV band gap, you will have a maximum voltage of 1.3. That's your theoretical one. And so if you get to 1.2, you should have a quantum efficiency of for light and the electroluminescence of a few percent. And that's what is observed. We get 4% quantum efficiency. So you can run these systems as a light emitting diode or as a photovoltaic, the same cell. It's the same cell, okay? It's an amazing thing. And here are the 4%, you can see them on this scale. And so this becomes a very good quality check for photovoltaics, this light emission property. Let me move forward. And so today, today's efficiencies are 22.1. And let me just point out to you that the blue points are polycrystalline silicon. So the perovskite have beaten, actually, polycrystalline silicon, the market leader in photovoltaics. So where are we now? Who's winning the race? Very early. I mean, this still is a laboratory cell, and we have to worry about stability. Cost-wise, it looks actually pretty good because, I mean, here's the annual analysis, which tells us it's the lowest cost of all photovoltaic technology. And you have here the materials cost. This is the most expensive part here is the Hall conductor, but this will change. There are cheap Hall conductors now around. So at the end, I mean, you see this analysis expressed the LCOE, the levelized cost of energy. That's what counts. How much you have to pay for 1 kilowatt hour electric energy. And so here, the prediction is 3 cents. 3 cents, and that's very competitive price. It assumes a 12% module efficiency and 15 years lifetime. So 12% module efficiency is around the corner. In fact, if you look at the scale-up, there are several approaches that allow scale-up. Here we have the Singapore, I'm just mentioning this module 11%. They have now beefed it up to 12. So these are all, this is screen printed films. They don't use any sophisticated technology. The whole photovoltaic device is screen printed. And here's the disol cell. They are very close in efficiency, not quite at this level, but very close. And here's a bigger module in the, actually this carbon cell comes from Wuhan. And I'm so proud to be associated. If you didn't notice my name here, it's the Michael Kratzel Center for cosmic solar cell, okay? That is expressed in Chinese, okay? So I was very proud to be named the honorary director of the center. And so, yeah, actually with the fuel generation, I will be very quick. I mean, the perovskite solar cells have been used as voltage source. They have this high voltage for fuel generation. And for a while, we were holding the record. But this, I think now the 3-5 semiconductors have kicked in a little bit higher than perovskite. But we're holding a record for CO2 conversion to CO. We started off with this paper, 6.5%. But recently, we have a new catalyst. It's Cooper's oxide on both the cathode and the anode. And the cathode side is a Cooper's oxide, or cupric oxide, with the tin oxide overlayer. And it makes it selective for CO2 to CO conversion. You can see that here. If you run the CO alone, it doesn't make much CO, but with the tin oxide ALD overlay, it does make your CO very selectively. And so that has been now scaled, and we get 13%, 13.4%. That's solar to chemical, okay? But if you count all the fuels, including the hydrogen that is formed, it's actually 16%. So impressive efficiencies for solar fuels with this particular system. And so now let me finish, because I was told to finish in about 5 minutes from now. So just show you at the end some applications, and then there will be, you can challenge me by questions. So here's some all the applications we see commercially are from the dye-sensitized cells. The first guy is, as I mentioned, they're now being scaled up, and we need to consolidate all of this. And the applications, we're talking to Mike McGee today on tandem cells, and so they're very promising perspectives for perovskites. But now we are talking about products out of the market, and these are IoT applications, Internet of Things, by companies like the G-Cell company in Great Britain. And this is the famous solar backpack, okay, that that was developed by the same company, and even Al Gore got one of those. And it was it was my back. It was the last one he had. Okay, he doesn't know that he has my back. Also I gave one to Bill Gates, and he likes the technology. Actually, he was very kind to us. He mentioned in his statement on the Paris conference, he mentioned the sensitized technology as being very promising for the future. And so here we see some applications. So as the chairman said, we have for the molecular photovoltaics, we have two applications. One is the building integration and panels, translucent panels make electricity from sunlight. And believe me, I have ordered myself for my house now these panels. So I must be convinced that they work, okay? So this is how they look from inside. They also have a heat reflection effect, because they have these two FTO layers. So they cut the heat inside. And this is our Congress Center at night. If you come to Geneva Airport, please admire our panels in the departure level. This is the filling station I showed you. This is on the highway from Bern to Zurich. Don't overlook our fence here when you drive along the highway. It does do a sizable production of electricity. And this is the Swisscom building, and very close to the site, the Korean company Dongchen is also very active. Here we get to mass production start in China. I don't know what that means here. I hope they. I hope it's nothing bad about me, because I can't read Chinese. But some of you might understand the Chinese here, so you have to tell me. And so here's the installation of the panels in China. So business going up. This is a very significant development in Sweden, where the company Exeger has just now raised 40 million to increase production capacity for the products. One of their products, if you go to their website, is an e-book reader. And what does it say? E-reader with eternal life, okay? So once you have it, you don't need to worry about battery anymore, okay? So, and in case you want to move to Sweden, okay? There are jobs available in this company, okay? just in case. So, at the end, very end of my presentation, I'd like to show you something very personal. We have this had this Expo 2015 in Milano, and there was this big disc that the company SFL from Austria had installed. And these are our glass panels, the 16 kilowatt power. And so I went there on the 11th of May. Now, this is a birthday. not only my birthday, but my wife also has same day birthday. So we never forget our birthdays, okay? So my wife Carol was coming with me and we got a birthday cake from the Austrians. But the real important thing was here, the truck. This truck was powered by the panels you saw. And those panels, remember these small molecules we made in the lab, finally powering a truck that is driving around. So a dream became true for me. It was a very emotional moment at this fair. So with that, I finish. My sponsors, financial support. Most importantly, you better ski in Switzerland. That blue sky you don't see in Lausanne, you're in a gray fog there, okay? So thank you for your attention.
Okay, so I think there's time for some questions for Professor Gressel. Well, I'll lead off with one. Okay, so Professor, in your presentation, you mentioned briefly the photoelectrochemical results, the new results with the copper oxide electrodes. I noticed that the pH was quite different between the two, the anodic and cathodic chambers. How practical is that to have to run it under those conditions?
You need this bipolar membrane. You saw that it was in the design. And what that does for you is it has an inner compartment where you have water. Mm. And the water is dissociating in protons and OH minus. So there is a potential across that membrane that will help you to dissociate the water, okay? But when you add all the losses up, it's it's like the water splitting reaction. The thermodynamics are the same. This membrane doesn't change a thing. Mm. It's just that you have to be careful with the flux of ions across, so leakage currents. And so this has been a challenge, but we have been able with the using cesium as a monovalent cation to prevent the transport of cesium ions across so that you want only protons to move,
right.
Okay?
Yeah.
OH minus are protons. Yeah. The moment you have other ions, it will mess up the system because it changes this composition on one side, on the other side. And so, it's for CO2 reduction, you need that bipolar membrane because you want to do the oxygen evolution in alkaline solution, and the CO2 is, per definition, a neutral solution.
Right.
And so this membrane works perfectly well if you have a pH 0 and 14. Mm. Then it's really perfect. It's more challenging when you have a neutral pH
like 7,
and a pH 14.
Yeah. Okay. Question, yes.
Could you give some idea about dollar per watt compared to other technologies? And the second question is that, do you think you will be able to scale this technology? I wish you can do, but up to megawatt and gigawatt level.
Which one are you talking about now? The perovskites or the first?
Yeah.
Oh, the perovskites.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, I mean, it's happening as we speak. Companies are investing and they... I showed you some of the scale-up products, Daisol and Singapore. There are various companies. The other day I was in Clarkson, at the Clarkson University in Potsdam, and somebody pulled out a perovskite cell, a venture capital person who had invested, and he wanted to show it to me. So we ignore all what is going on. There's a lot of activity out there, I can tell you that. And not only for the cells themselves, but also the tandem I mentioned to you, the tandem where you have a technology like silicon and you build on this technology. Yeah? So in my opinion, if you had asked me 2 years ago, I wrote a review on perovskite solar cell called the the light and shade of perovskite solar cell. And that there are a lot of uncertainties about stability and the lead problem and so on. Today, I think if you had this solar farms and you have a contained glass with concrete support, you're okay. I mean, you have less lead than silicon panels, so per square meter. And so that's all reasons to be optimistic.
Further questions?
This is a bit of a follow-up, but you caught my attention with the 3 cents per kilowatt hour, because I know from either straight-up technology comparisons or modeling studies, that looks pretty good, which was your point. How soon, where and when can we buy those in your... I guess one impressive thing about your talk was going all the way from deep in the lab at the nano level all the way through to the market, and there are probably very few people who can do that whole spectrum of thinking about what's going on.
Yeah, my brain was turning really at the fifth gear. So anyway, good question. It's a good question. We should be very careful not to overstate. When I talk to investors, I always tell the truth. Okay, I never exaggerate. And since I have been investing myself in startup companies, and I know how it hurts if somebody doesn't tell you the full truth, so I'll be very frank to you. This still is an early time, but the risk is coming down very quickly. Okay. And you have seen those stability results. Also, Mike McGee showed me very good stability. So we are going through those test programs. The IEC 61146, or 61146, I forgot now the code. So there is a test program. And we have seen that, for example, carbon cells, you can take them through all these tests, the critical tests that the IEC calls for outdoor photovoltaics. And so it will still take some time to be fully reassured on whether the stability is what we really need for 25 years outdoor. But so far what we can say is the things that go wrong, it's not really the perovskite. It's very often the contact materials or something else corroding or water penetrating. So these materials are much more rugged than we had believed, especially if you take the methyl ammonium out. So my feeling is that we should keep going. It's a winning card.
Quick questions? Yes.
So regarding the very long stability that you observed, can you give us your expert opinion as to the key mechanisms that perovskite solar cell must avoid to be stable for thousands and thousands of hours?
Yeah, so one issue was the contacts. I mentioned that. So a lot of scientists use gold as a contact, and the whole conductor, the classic one, is something we introduced 20 years ago. It's called the spiroammetate. It's a triarylamine. And so these materials are not stable enough. This whole conductor is just for research. You should never, it costs also too much. It costs $500 per gram, okay? So you need about 1 gram of this whole conductor material for 1 square meter. So you're already dead with $500 per square meter. You will not be able to be competitive. So, but it's a very good research material. You can buy it, it's working, and it's not the final story. So new materials are being used, and I'm sure that we have ourselves something in print, which I unfortunately cannot disclose here, but the whole conductors are really very promising now, the inorganic whole conductors. I think we can be positive on this one. So I would pay attention to those contact materials. I would take the methyl ammonium cation out of the perovskite. It's a pain in the neck. At 85 degrees, it disappears. You make lead iodide, okay? So that has to be taken out. But if you take these other formulations, they will be very rugged. unless you flood yourself with water. I mean, this is still, this ambient contact is an issue, but that's an issue for any photovoltaic. Now, they're all laminated because you want to protect them.
Question?
Yeah, can you talk a little bit about manufacturing processes? Are there particular kinds of things that are needed for the perovskites?
The one I showed you, they're being screen printed. So you can go to NTU in Singapore, they show you that, how they make those modules, and they get 11% on the module. And so that's not the only technique, the slot die coating, certainly not spin coating. Okay, take the spin coat out, it's not going to work. That's why new procedures have been developed that avoid the spin coating. And so are they new, really? Well, for the perovskite, yes, but I think these are existing thin film deposition techniques.
I think there was a question back there.
Yes. I just wanted to continue a little bit on your reliability question that you're answering. It's really certainly a very interesting topic. You know, among the three critical tests, damp heat, temperature cycling, and the light soak, what's actually more fundamental is light soak in many ways. If its material starts to degrade, if you shine light on it, then you know it defeats the purpose of being a solar cell. What are the particular things in your utopian dream stack which would actually prevent it from actually would enable it to be resistant to any issues with light? For example, if there's organics, or certain kinds of organics, which may deteriorate with light exposure.
Well, with the dye sense dye cells, we had problems with the heat test. And so that is solved for the perovskite. It's a piece of cake, really, now to get a formulation that takes you over 90 days, 85 degrees. Just think about it, 85 degrees, 90 days. If you would go in a sauna and stay and at 85 degrees over 90 days, I wonder what is left. And so it's a harsh test, and it's even harsher. The real test puts 85% humidity in addition. So you need to absolutely be sure about your sealant. That's mainly a sealant issue, a lamination issue. And so that's a harsh test, but I think if you've got a good sealant, and then the perovskite will take that. It's easy enough. And you have seen, we have done one experiment over 500 hours where we clobbered it in addition with the full sun, okay? And we had to sell work at maximum power. If there was only a 5% decline. But yeah, that was. Yeah. The trouble with that test is now the referees ask me all the time to repeat that test. So, but it's not in the norm. It was beyond norm. We have set the wrong standard now. So anyway, it was a good experiment, and it showed that this can be very stable. It's not the whole answer, though. We have to be careful and do more testing. I would say it will probably take about 5 years to sort all of this out and have confidence. Between 3 and 5. With a carbon technology, the stability is very good. So that's why you already see modules being made.
Well, I'm sure there are many more questions to ask. I know there are. But we probably need to cut the formal questioning off here. There may be opportunities to speak with Professor Getzel at the end of the presentation. But let's thank him once again for a very stimulating lecture.